right, well, this is Aaron Squire coming to you guys again this week. We've got episode 102, and I'm calling it Do the Impossible, Target the Untargetable. See, I had to read it off of my paper that I wrote, so it's a good thing I wrote it down like that. We'll also be talking about some of the recent metagame changes that we've seen from the Five Shards tournament. We're going to do a YouTube giveaway. Stick around after the show. We're going to do a giveaway after the show, which we do every week during the live show. We'll talk about some of the Hex news that's going on. We've got some artwork cards and some Let's Play action. Some of the events that are coming up. Gen Con, which I'm going to be out at, of course, again this year. And we're going to talk about some of the things that are going on with the Reddit threads recently this week. We've seen a lot of complaints about my favorite guy, Mr. Fuzzico. And we'll finish things up by building a mono ruby aggro build for a user called Conform for Crit, which is he's in the channel right now. So thanks for submitting that today, or for allowing me to use your deck idea. All right, let's see here. So let's go ahead and start things off right with some of the things that we've been doing this week. So I don't have any guests on. So this week I've mostly been, honestly, like working on that tech from last week because it's got me so interested, the using all the constants in the game. But I found that, for the most part, Wild, Ruby, and Diamond were the shards I really wanted to play, and Sapphire somewhat, and Blood not so much when I played that deck. So I tried a couple of different things out. I mean, you do want to have access to Blood, but you know, that's not something that seemed to be a big deal. Anyways, let's move on to the YouTube giveaway real quick before we go on to some of the other things that are going on. So we've got a couple of people in here. Let's see, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people here, and then we'll get, the winner's going to get a draft. So number 5, it looks like Zimic, he wins a lot of stuff. So Zimic is my winner, and I will contact him to get his in-game stuff later. I believe I already have it, though. Let's go ahead and look at some of these new decks that we're seeing in the metagame. So we'll start off by looking at let's start from the bottom and work our way up. Now, a lot of people were really surprised with the 150 card Jankbot deck in Blood and Wild, so that's probably one of the more interesting builds. But here we've got Wyant running a Diamond Blood, or this is a mono diamond build, actually, sorry. Mono diamond build, and one of the main cards he's running in here is Grace of Tianos, and you can't see it very well, but it says target troop you control gains +2/+2 flight, and when this dies, revert it and put it into play. So playing Grace of Tianos allows you to basically recursion a character or troop for free after they die the very first time. And then, of course, he's running Protectorate Defender with Solidarity, which gives all your guys +1/+1. So throwing those guys in the sky seems pretty good. It's just a very efficient build, and a lot of people have been talking about William Rowan. William Rowan obviously does a lot of work in this deck as well. And, of course, I cannot read him, so I'm actually going to flip over to TCG Browser so I can actually read that a little bit better. Yeah, William Rowan is a 2-cost 3/2, so very good body for the cost. He says, when he enters play, create a Rowan and put it into your deck. William Rowan attacks, move each Rowan in your deck up 5 spaces. If the top card of your deck is Rowan, put him into play. So Rowan is his dog, and the dog is a 5/5 steadfast swift striker, so seems pretty sick for the diamonds, the mono diamond builds, to be playing this guy. So fairly strong build. It's nice for those people that want to play the mono diamonds, kind of a weenie build. We also have, of course, Rally of Kings, which is your anthem effect that gives all your guys +1/+1, and you can empower it and double the effect, which can push your guys out of range of things like Heat Wave, which can clear out all your guys. Very efficient. Of course, he's running Martyr in short supply. One of the ones I'm surprised he's not playing here, I guess he just couldn't find room for it, is he's not playing the princess, or the royal, let's see, it's royal, the Royal Den Mother. I'm surprised he's not playing this one. I guess he just couldn't find space for it. I do see that, yeah, Royal Den Mother does kind of die to Heat Wave, so there is that, and it's more maybe of a pet deck type of thing, but I've always liked this card, and you know, if I was playing Mono Diamond, I would probably try to find a way to fit it in, but yeah, maybe he just figures he doesn't need it. Of course, we've got Spearcliff Cloud Knight, which around a long time ago we used to call it like the what do we call it, Bane's, we call it like Baneslayer Pony, something like that. That was a long time ago. And that is pretty much his deck. So pretty straightforward. Did pretty well in the tournament. And these are some of the best players in the last format. So these are definitely things to watch out for. Moving on, we've got Peace Tinker. And he ran a Blood Sapphire deck, more of the spiders type of things. And, of course, he's running the combo of Azure Face Sorceress with Major Sapphire of Subterfuge and Minor Sapphire of Mischief, which allows you to play it at Swift Speed. Oh, it's a wolf, not a dog. Yeah, that's true. So what you do is basically you play it in your opponent's end step after you've already played Fentio and put some of the eggs in your opponent's deck. And hopefully if you hit one of those eggs, you can just mill through their entire deck if it hits enough eggs, because it mills another egg, puts a 5/5 into play, the 5/5 mills them five more. I've actually seen Jadim Jedi during the $100,000 tournament. He got milled out all in one turn, 40 cards by that combo. So pretty sick combo, and there's a lot of just must-answer things. Things are hard to deal with. We've got the Inquisitor all the way back from the very first edition, bouncing all around, using its brutality to shrink the front end of a lot of troops. Xenos Malice is a new one, though. Let's go ahead and pull that one up to get a good, better look at that. So Xenos Malice is pay 2 health, create a spiraling eggs for each opposing champion and put them into their decks, sacrifice a spider, and then draw a card and then gain 2 health. So if your opponent sweeps you out, you could respond by using up all your resources and then sacrificing all your spiders and drawing a bunch of cards. Seems like a pretty sick card. It feeds into itself. Pretty awesome. This, especially if you're running the spiders decks, you're probably going to want to run this over the typical Blood, the other blood constant, which is I'm forgetting the name of it right now, but there's another blood constant, which is pay 2 health, draw a card, and you can do that, or pay 2 health, pay 3 and draw a card. I'm trying to remember what the name of it is now. Blood, I don't think it's blood, I think it's something else, but if you use that card like that, that seems a lot better. Seems like it's going to do a lot more work for you. All right, and of course he's running Xenos Silk. Just a simple, like, spider build, really. And Exarch of the Egg, of course, does a lot of work. Now, there has been some talk recently about how, not Fuzzico, but how the new Shin Hair, I forget it, Hierophant. Yeah, the new Rune Ear Hierophant is going up in value. And people are having a hard time with it right now because basically you always have spell shield on it. The second gem is minor, and so we see a lot of spell shield on it, and cards like Xenos and not Xenos Inquisitor, but Exarch of the Egg do a good job of at least trading off for it. So that's one of the decent answers right now to Hierophant. So there's actually been a lot of complaints on the Reddit forums about it, and there's also some talk about some of the gems rotating out, and so maybe if they get rid of the spell shield gem from Wild, then Hierophant won't be as much of a menace as he is right now. So, you know, it's just something to keep an eye on, but most of the talk of the town during this tournament was Hierophant. Moving on, we've got Sapphire Wild Uzu. So this is more of a, looks like a, says you get double shard deck. I was running Arborian Root Father, you know, your Azure Fate Sorceress, Crocosaurs, the typical Sapphire Wild build. Of course, these guys Hierophants in there with Wild Orb of Dominance, which gives you a 3/3 Rhino when you deal damage to your opponent, which is the typical thing from what I've been told that people are running in the Hierophant, because then when that Rhino comes into play, your Hierophant goes up +1/+1, because Hierophant gets +1/+1 permanently as you play troops. I think that that's another thing that maybe could have been changed to have made Hierophant a lot more of a risky thing to play. If maybe that was only for that turn, maybe that would have been a little bit more reasonable for Hierophant. But just the fact that you can have an untargetable troop that can get bigger and bigger as the game progresses makes it a big deal. We also see the return of Master Moss in this deck, which is one of my favorites. A 5-5 that when it dies goes to your graveyard, transforms into a 2-2, and then the 2-2 Mossling comes into play. And then if that Mossling deals damage to your opponent, it reverts back into the Wrathwood Master Moss. Very much a classic throwback to something that we've seen before. And of course he's running Uzu the Bone Walker for fixing in there. Next we've got Mars playing Mono Wild Fuzzico. So he's just basically all in on Fuzzico, and he's got Puck the Dreambringer. Wellspring's another one that people are talking a lot about recently. Wellspring is kind of like, and a lot of people are saying this, it's kind of like your Chlorophylia 4 and 5. I actually played a little bit with it after I listened to some people talk about it in the Constance deck from last week, because it felt like I have always, in that deck, I always end up with a lot of cards in hand, and I don't have the resources to play them, so ramping off of both Chlorophylia and Wellspring seems really good, and these are resources that your opponent really has a hard time getting rid of, compared to if you're playing with your resource dorks being your 1-1s that come into play on turn 1. You can exhaust them and then get your resources into play, so seems pretty good. It also gives you Wild Threshold, which I think combos really well with Eternal. Let's see, it's Eternal, not Guardian, but Eternal Sage. So Eternal Sage, its wild portion says that you can get to buff one of your troops, even himself, +3/+3. And I guess I'll just hover over it. +3/+3 this turn when you play a wild shard. So if you play that card, then you get two wild shards, or you get a wild shard for every resource you play, rather. Actually, it's for every resource you play when you play Wellspring. So you get X resources. So that comboed with Eternal Sage could end games right away. If, let's say it's, if you had 8 resources up and you play an Eternal Sage and it goes unanswered and there's no blockers for it for some reason, and then you top deck a Wellspring, well, then you can Wellspring for 4, right? Because it's double X, so you have to pay 2X to get just 1. Then it's Eternal Sage is going to buff itself +3/+3 4 times, which is 12, so that's 17 damage. So that's pretty good for Eternal Sage to be able to do that much damage all in one turn like that. So I think that's something in the future we're going to see a little bit more of, is that combo together. We don't really see it too much here. We've got Eternal Guardian being played in this deck. I'm surprised that no one played Eternal Sage in their decks that were playing Wellspring, especially after the last tournament when we saw Jadeem Jedi just use it to such good effect for the finals to win the $100,000 tournament. Next, we've got the Biz's Bloodwild 150 card Jankbot deck, and you know it's really frustrating to get beat by a Jankbot deck. This one just basically plays all the money cards. Of course, it's playing its Hierophants. It's playing Rotten Rancor, which is kind of interesting. Reap is a new removal card, which is better and worse than Murder, or Kill rather, because Murder changed into Kill. And of course, it's running ridiculous Jankbot, which if Jankbot hits the table and then it gets unanswered for a full turn and gets to swing, you're going to get 3 cards out of your deck, put them into play. Seems pretty sick. It's also running some other random one-offs like Jadeem, Heart of the Wrathwood, Argus is in there. So it's just running a bunch of good stuff. It also has some nice fixing, though, with your Cottontail Explorer. I expect to see this guy played a lot in the new expansion as well, just because he gives you those resources. He's like virtual card draw with him. Let's just look at Rotten Rancor real quick before we move on to the next deck. So Rotten Rancor is 5 cost, basic action speed. It says put target troop from your crypt into play. That troop then battles target opposing troops. So you could actually battle something and then it could go back into your crypt with it. But it's kind of a nice, little surprise. It's kind of like, oh, I'm finally over this. I finally killed your Hierophant, and then you resurrect it and then kill something with it because it's like a 4-4 or something, or, you know, even bigger with Rotten Rancor. So seems like a pretty nice little surprise type of thing to be able to play. Another card that they talked about, you know, dealing fairly well with Hierophant is Closed Coffins. So Closed Coffins, I have to keep pulling it up because it's so tiny over there. Closed Coffins is a good bring-in against Hierophant because it says if opposing troop would die, void it, and then for each opposing troop of the same name in the hands, decks, and the crypts, you void those as well. So it's a good way to just to dump out, you know, problematic troops that you know your opponent's playing four of, so that way you only have to deal with one. This makes your opponent play their Hierophant much less, you know, like risky. In risky ways where it is that they can lose them. Not that there should be that many, you know, ways that that's going to happen, but, you know, Closed Coffins seems like a decent answer, or at least a helpful answer to deal with that. And I think it's going to see a lot more play, even against, like, mono diamond decks. It'll see some play. Moving on. Let's see. Actually, we need to go back to the decks. We're still looking at all the deck lists. Okay, there's Xantosh's Diamond Wild Fuzzico. So he's kind of splashing diamonds so he can pick up like Rally of the Kings, Martyr, High Infinitrix. And Infinitrix is another one that a lot of people were talking about as well. And there she is. So Infinitrix allows you to shift Flight, Steadfast, Life Drain, and then when you play Necrotic, you get to revert it. So it can basically dole out all of its powers, and then you just play some necrotics and then revert it, and then you can keep pushing those powers out. So by itself, without doing anything to it, it is a 3-4 with Flight, Steadfast, and Life Drain, and then you can just basically push that those powers out to things, which seems pretty sick. Let's see, what else have we got in here? Cheese Smith, of course, has seen a lot of play. I played a little bit with him. He's another decent answer to Hierophant just because he has lethal. So basically anything with lethal or anything that you can pump, pump spells might start making a little bit of a comeback just to try to trick the Hierophant into attacking or at least hold him at bay. Then we've got Young Seer down here, which is another, that's kind of an interesting choice, I think. I've played him more in the limited sense. Young Seer, but he says prophecy, when this enters play, the next troop in your deck gets cost minus 2. I'm not sure that this is really a great card for this deck. It's a 1/2, I guess, for one, which is, you know, a nice body for the cost, but I just don't know that that's really gonna help out with the efficiency of the deck. I suppose that it is running some pretty expensive stuff because you're running Angel of Dawn, that doesn't really matter because you top deck it anyways. Balthazar is 6. You can play free Carnosaurus with it. Emancipator. Okay, Emancipator, I could see it being kind of a big deal because in order to get Greenpaw Emancipator's doubling his Empower, you have to make him cost 10, and 10's a lot of resources to get to. But if I can make him cost 3, then I can double him for 6, and that's, you know, only one more than his basic cost, so, and still get, I could get 4 Shroompin, and all the Shroomkin get +1/+1. Yeah, this guy's seeing a lot of play as well right now, so I guess that's what the deck is trying to do, is it's just trying to get value out of that guy and play him quicker for his double cost with the Young Seer and just hope that you hit him. Still, I don't know that I would play it, though. It just seems like that may not happen as often as I would need it to happen. Rally of the Kings is another good one, of course. We talked about that earlier. Let's move on to the next deck. We've got Replays Blood Wild Kog'Lichu. So Kog'Lichu is a champion that takes the bottom 3 cards of your deck, throws them into your crypt, and then one of those cards goes back into your hand. He's actually playing a little bit of his spiders with the Fentio. He's got Munaro Sensei. It's another classic one. The Lily Pad, an Emancipator. Freakin' Nature is another one that a lot of people were talking about how, I guess during the tournament, there were times when people would block with their Azure Fate Sorceress. There was a play where somebody blocked with an Azure Fate Sorceress and she was down to one health, and then they discarded Freak of Nature to give it the other -1/-1 on it. So Freak of Nature, when I previewed it, I thought it was going to be somewhat difficult to play. I guess in this deck, you know, you can do some work with it, but double blood and double wild just feels like it might be too difficult. But I don't know. I gotta actually try it first. You know, you can. Yeah, I'm sure you could get some work out of it. But basically, yeah, at the end of the turn, opposing troop gets -1/-1, and at the start of the turn, if this is in your crypt, it gets bigger. Random opposing troop. So I'm guessing that whatever it was, the Azure Fate Sorceress was the only troop in play in that case. But it seemed like that would have been a pretty exciting play. They're saying Crocosaur was one of the most played cards last week as well. So, you know, it's definitely not being a 4-of still these days, as it used to be like an auto 4-of. But moving on, we've got the final deck is basically a wild deck that dips in the blood just for, or dips in a Sapphire for Azure Fate Sorceress, and then it plays some Ruby just so you can play the gems on the Azure Fate Sorceress, Major Ruby of Destruction. So the combo here is, and with Conservation, so the Conservation gives Azure Fate Sorceress the Spell Shield, and it's going to give the Wrathwood Master Moss, which is what you're optimally trying to play, Spell Shield as well. So the deck basically makes an infinite Wrathwood Master Moss that you can only get rid of if you are able to place that out of play. It's still targetable, or it's untargetable. So yeah, there's really no good way to deal with a spell shielded Wrathwood Master Moss with Ruby of Destruction. Every time you kill it, of course, it makes the 2/2. The 2/2 comes into play, deals damage to your opponent's face. It's just basically impossible to deal with, except I guess you could chump block it for quite some time, or maybe throw a blocker in front of it that doesn't die, like something that's indestructible that's not going to kill it. I suppose that might be a way to deal with it, but it's pretty sick putting those two things together. It's just that before this time, there weren't as many ways to get to the extra resources you needed to, and so in order to do that, they are using Shard Prism. So Shard Prism, I'll bring it up again on the other one. We actually put this in the deck last week because we were playing 5 different shards in our deck. But with this one, we really only need 1 threshold in Ruby and 1 threshold in Sapphire. I should just have typed in Prism. There it is, Shard Prism. So it doesn't give you any threshold unless you cycle it, unless you discard it and then gain a threshold of your choice and then draw a card, but then you don't get the resource out of it. So it's one of those things where on the average you're pretty much going to be cycling this card, so it's not really a resource so much as it's going to be a spell for your deck. So you have to be careful when you're playing Shard Prism. It almost feels like if you're playing 23 resources already, Shard Prism almost counts as 4 spells more than it does, you know, 4 more resources. So just keep that in mind if you're going to run Shard Prism, I'd say, and how you're counting your resources. But, you know, it seems like a pretty exciting deck. This is actually a deck that's not running, you know, it's one of the most annoying cards that people are saying in the format, which is the Hierophant. So, at least I'm not seeing it. It might be in the reserves. No, he's not running Hierophant in this deck. Seems pretty interesting that he's not doing that. He's basically just trying to combo out Azure Fate Sorceress with Master Moss, or there's other targets for it as well. You know, you have Root Father Balthazar can do it, Crocosaur can do it, Eternal Sage. So there you go. There's your Eternal Sage. So he may have had some turns where he actually did what we talked about, where Eternal Sage was in play, and then he Wellsprings for a bunch, and then Eternal Sage just gets massive, and he just swings in for the win. So I like that. I like that there's definitely other things that this deck does, and how he's playing Eternal Sage. Plus, Eternal Sage combos really well with the Shard Prism, because if we need to, we can exhaust our opponent's troops by playing Sapphire. We can sweep out their field. If we have 2 Shard Prisms, we can actually discard 2 of them, get 2 Ruby, and you know, deal 2 damage to our opponent's field, which is virtually a... It's a one-sided heat wave, which is pretty exciting. There's just a lot of different things, a lot of synergy. So this may be the new way to play wild, is basically play at least, you know, maybe not so much play the combo of Azure Fate Sorceress and Wrathwood Mastermoss. I mean, I do love this combo, but, you know, at least play, I would say, the Eternal Sage and the Wellspring. And what is it? What else have we got in there that I was talking about? The Wellspring and the Shard Prism. I think that those things work together really well and work really well by themselves. So, moving on to some of the news from Hex, and we're actually kind of blazed through this. We can get to the Deck Doctor tonight. So we have history of a Hex card. So this is, I'm sure this is a good read. I haven't again gotten the chance to read it because I've been a little bit busy. But we've got, here's the William Rowan card, and so somebody just basically poses and they take a picture and then throw it up on the card to get an idea of what it's going to look like, and then they're also building the idea of what the deck, what the card's going to do in the deck. And then we have Rowan, this 5/5 troop, and they just took it another placeholder picture, and they just kind of take you through the steps of, like, let's build the card, let's make it powerful but not too powerful, let's, you know, wheel it back in, here's some more placeholder art, we get more art, and then eventually we end up with the final piece of artwork and the final card. So very interesting how it is that they move through those processes. Next we've got, of course, the convention season that's coming up. So if you happen to be in Germany, it looks like there's the RPC convention, which is May 28th to May 29th. So you can meet the GameForge team, and I'm not sure if they're looking for people to work. I do know some of my friends over in Germany are working at for GameForge, the company over there, which handles a lot of the Hex backend servers and server support. Then you've got the San Diego Comic-Con International. I know a lot of people like to go to this. You know, I'm not a big Comic-Con type of person just because I'm more on the game side of things, but, you know, if Hex is there, you know, I'd love to be there. Unfortunately, I just don't live close enough to California to go, but you know, if you're out there, you know, maybe send me some pictures or tweet some pictures back to me. And then, of course, Gen Con, which I will end up going to because I'll be working for Soda Pop Miniatures again for this one, and so I'll be out there at Gen Con. So if you're out there, you know, come and say hello. I'll probably be in the Hex pit mostly at the nighttime because I'll be working during the daytime. You know, hit me up. You know, we'll get a drink or something. Next, we've got the VIP schedule, which is next week, May 27th, 28th, and 29th. And so you have a chance to win Grace of Tienos and Psionic Flame. The VIP rewards are, you know, I like what we're getting. Some people, I guess, were complaining about the cards not being Tier 1, but we're seeing Grace of Tienos played. I think Psionic Flame, I wanted to almost do a Psionic Flame deck tonight just because people said that it wasn't that playable. I mean, I could definitely see it in some sort of a tempo Ruby Sapphire deck that just, you know, does a lot of bouncing and that sort of thing. So, you know, I still think it's decent. Drawing cards plus dealing damage seems pretty good. The only problem is it costs double X to do it. So, you know, they're trying to rein in to make sure you're not drawing too many cards. I suppose what I would probably do is play some of the accelerators in Ruby to get the extra resources. So that way I could at least get five. So at least five, so we could draw two cards and do two damage. It'd be nice if it was quick action speed too, but, you know, that may have been asking them a little bit too much. And of course, they're going through some of the other news we already talked about. I guess there's a primordial knowledge stream tonight, so in-depth knowledge of the analysis of the Hex Gauntlet. So if you want to get over to that in the Hex meta, they'll teach you all about that stuff. And then, of course, we've got Hex Silver League is coming up, which is a lot like the Rock League. So for all the people that aren't, especially the free-to-play people, this is going to be a great opportunity for you to get out and play some PvP tournaments against other players, because all you need are commons and uncommon cards, because legendaries and rares are banned in this format. So it's basically an all-common, all-uncommon format. So that seems like a pretty good thing for the community, especially for those free-to-play players that maybe not getting the PvP itch that they wanted to get. Another side note, something I wanted to talk about, though, is I was listening to the podcast for the Threshold podcast today, and they talked about how it was that we don't have ladder in the game, and some of the Chinese servers may be getting ladder or something like that. And something I think that would be nice if it came back, I don't know if this will or not, but a long time ago when you used to queue up for random matches against other players, you would get 100 gold for using that queue. And I think that that wouldn't be too bad of something to come back, or maybe something like that on ladder, where, you know, maybe you pay a certain amount of gold to play it or something as a gold sink, and then, like, if you win, you get something. Or maybe even in the future, I think it would be nice to do, like, phantom drafts with gold. I think that that would be something, and then if you do well in the draft, then you get, like, one pack of cards. Like, if you win the draft, you get one pack of cards, and the phantom draft cost, I don't know, maybe, like, 10,000 gold or something like that. And that's, I think that that would be reasonable for free-to-play players. You know, to start getting some packs and stuff. If they don't want to go and try to play the auction house or something else, I think that would be reasonable. You know, a lot of people look at things like Hearthstone when they look at monetization, which isn't really fair, but, you know, because their cards are not tradable, basically the limited format, you don't get to keep your cards. So I don't know. It doesn't make that much sense to me. So tonight we'll be building this deck for Conform Crit, who's in the channel, and for submitting this deck, you know, I'll get him something nice as well. So he's basically, the challenge is we have to use his collection, which is on the second screen, but we're going to look at what the deck is that he has right now, and I'll give him some of my ideas. So he's running the basically a 1 and 2 cost deck and about 20 resources in here. So 20 ruby shards, so a very low curve. He only needs really one resource to go with any hands in this deck. He's running the 2 crushing blows. I think he probably could have gone up on those to 4 in the deck. I mean, you know, just because if I was going to get rid of something, I would probably get rid of Soul of Battle. Maybe one of those. The ruby aura as well. I think Crushing Blow is just going to give you more mileage than those other two cards combined. The other thing to look at with a deck like this, to me, is it's not such a bad thing maybe to bump it up to like 21 or 22 shards, and then have maybe some 3 drops, and that be your top end. I think, you know, 4 3 drops as a top end that are solid picks could have worked fairly well for this. But this is, you know, a straight up aggro, I'm trying to race you deck type of a thing, and I think that he did, you know, this should do a decent job and then come underneath some decks. I know that decks like Winter Moon would probably have some issues with something like this stabilizing out of that situation, that early situation. The only other thing I would talk about with a deck like this is the fact that you aren't able to race someone when they're, you know, out healing you. And so, like, one I'm trying to remember the dinosaur's name. It's a dinosaur. At least I can look it up. If they actually get to a place where they can play, not Crocosaur, but if they can play a Succulent Cluckodon against this deck, I think that that kind of blows it out. Like, that, this card by itself blows the whole deck out. And so because of that, I think that it's fairly important for a deck like this to have, at least in the reserves, the Witch, the Ruby Witch, the Ember Spire Witch. I think this is another card that's kind of underplayed in the Ruby genre, just because, you know, people don't think, oh yeah, if they don't gain health, then I can make sure that my clock is exactly what I need it to be. It also has Swift Strike, so you can actually trick with this because you've got access to burn in your deck. It would be nice to maybe have some more quick action removal in our burn spells, but, you know, unfortunately, you know, some of the cards that we have access to right now, Crackling Bolt's probably the best choice. So initially, when I thought about this deck today and I was building something, I built a mono ruby elf deck, but I'm looking through some of the things that he has, and it doesn't look like he has a lot of set 4 cards just yet, so that may not work for him. So let's look through what he does have in here. Okay, so he has the Gore Feast, and I think that this would be an excellent choice for a deck like this. So we bump up the resources to like 21 or 22 and play the single Gore Feast, and if you have board state, you know, he can win games outright by itself, you know, with just the Gore Feast. So this is a possibility, especially if we end up playing a decent amount of Swift Strikers. It's bumping up the Rage one on their front end. If he could afford it, of course, and maybe even go up to 22 or 23 resources, then he could play cards like Falconer. Falconer is another card that definitely combos really well with our Gore Feast of Kog'Tepetl. Falconer gives us extra bodies. It, of course, makes these Royal Falcons. It makes two Royal Falcons. And the only problem is it's kind of a weak body. And so Falconer hasn't seen as much play as it used to. But it's still a fairly good card, right? As far as where you're going to invest your money. So maybe now might not be a bad time to buy a Falconer. Because it's just not seeing the play that it used to see. Especially back in the in the first and second set days. He's got one. He's got his three of these Emberleaf Duelists, and if you're gonna play the Elf deck, I think that this is a decent staple card for it. But it's not one of the more powerful Elves you could play in there. He does. Oh, he does have the Empress. Wait. What am I looking at? I am looking at his collection. So maybe he is playing Emberspire Witch in the reserves, and if he is, then I commend him for that. Because we're looking at his collection. Let's see the main deck. Yeah, I don't see it in the main deck. And does it have reserves? Let's see if it's in the reserves. Oh, sure. Okay, so good. He's got the Ember Spire Witch in the reserves. He's also got Highlands Blackbelt. Now, I would contend that Highlands Blackbelt is good enough that we can play it main deck, especially when we're playing Urgnock, just because you buff its front end and then you put like something like Breath of the Dragon in your hand, which is it deals 2 damage to your opponents, depending on what the Highlands Blackbelt's front end is. Of course, if you're going to play these in the main deck, then you may want to play the human that buffs their front end, which I'm forgetting the name of all of a sudden. It's been a bad day for me to remember the names of cards. And we will just look at Ruby. We'll just look at Ruby cards. Where are you? There you are, Ruby Pyromancer. So Ruby Pyromancer combos really well with the Highlands Black Belt because you play the Pyromancer first and then play the Black Belt right after it. It buffs the front end of the Black Belt. Now it does more damage with its extra spell, or it could do extra stuff with its other abilities as well. All right, let's go back to the collection and see what else he's got. Oops, wrong one. Okay, so he's got the Gem Crazed Berserker. This is another one that you can throw the Ruby Gem in where he can't be blocked unless you have a Ruby Troop. It's not too many Ruby Troops. We went through the meta today. I don't remember seeing that many Ruby Troops. Now, it can be blocked by artifacts, and so you do have to be ready for that Eternal Sage that people are running. This guy's not running it. So against this deck, it would have been perfectly fine. At least I think it would. No, never mind. Yeah, Eternal Sage is in there. I mean, it's only 4 cards, but you do have to be aware of that. Hopefully, you're fast enough that you can just beat it to the punch. He's also got Veteran Guardian Gladiator, which is another classic that we saw back in the old first set days. Stopping things from blocking you is kind of a big deal, especially when we're trying to get those final points of damage in. Let's see, what else? He's got Burn to the Ground. He's got 4 of those. That's another one I think that is an okay like single in a deck like this, just because at the end of the game, hopefully, you know, you top deck it at just the right time and you have like, you know, somewhere between 5 and 7 resources in play, and you just burn your opponent's face and win the game outright, and hopefully they don't have the counter for it. Let's see, what else? So it seems like he's put a decent amount into this deck. Honestly, probably some of the things he probably could do to give him maybe a little bit more reach is we could go dwarves. He does have he's got some machinist in here, or machinist, depending on how you want to pronounce that. We could go dwarves, and you know, most of those cards are pretty cheap. He does have 3 Terabots in here. Let's see, what else could we do in here? Well, let's start building the deck out. I think we're ready to start. We've got enough that we can kind of start building this deck out. So let's go ahead and change our shards to just Ruby and then Shardless. So basically, we could try to do the Elf thing like I was doing earlier. Or he is in the channel, so you can like tell me which direction you'd like to go with this Mono Ruby deck. Do you want to stay Mono Ruby? Another consideration I had was maybe trying to push into the orcs a little bit and play the new orc champion. So let's take a look at him real quick. Let's see. Okay, where is he? I should just have it on champion. That's what I need to do. Nope, not that guy. Okay. It's probably going to be towards the bottom. So there's a new orc champion that says your spells do one more point of damage for just this turn. Here he is. Nope, not Bomb. Is it Bombas? No, I don't want Bombas. Is he not here? He should be here. Here he is, this guy. Yodel. Oh, he updated his collection. Okay. So with this guy, we could run more damage spells. It says non-combat damage dealt by your cards is increased by one this turn. And then we could run maybe even like there's a dwarf that increases your damage by non-combat damage by one as well. So adding two to all your spells could definitely add a lot more value to the deck. The problem is, if you're going to do that, we kind of need to run more orcs. We're going to go more in that direction, and you're going to need the shard for that. That's the big issue that I would see with that. There's a there's an orc shard. That is what we would need for that. So resource. Yeah, so here it is. That's not it. Where is it? I probably just passed it by too. Here it is. This one. Yeah, so this gives us the blood or the ruby for the deck, which is what we would need. And as Orc Allegiance, so we're running orcs, of course. Random orc you control in your hand gets rage one. Okay, that's, I guess, interesting. The biggest reason why we want this in the deck is just so we can play blood and ruby, so we can play our ability. So we might even run four of these, and you could just run all mono ruby and maybe play like one or two blood cards or none at all, and, you know, still get a good effect from these. I actually really like that we can do that in Hex. Like, we can play things like Lily Pad and get value out of it if we play like all wild or all blood, for instance. We could still get Battle Hoppers, which we could use for something else. Or if I run these elves, I can run all ruby and then still gain 3 health and basically run a mono ruby deck. And I still have access to wild, so I could play like 2 artifact removal in the reserves or something like that. You know, artifact and constant removal. Anyways, we're going to stick with the mono ruby, though. And we've got about 15 minutes to kind of build this deck out. So I think I kind of want to build the elf deck, because I think there are some really interesting elves. So let's go ahead and try to do that direction. Now, what you have is perfectly fine. I would just consider maybe trying to find some 3 drops and things to kind of move into. All right, let's see here. Actually, I could probably just type in elf, which is what I did, actually, the first time I did this. All right, so some of these are cards that you're gonna play in a lot of drafts and things anyways, just because they're good. Elf, under its play under your control, it gets speed. When a troop costs 5 or greater, it also gets speed. So this gives all of our elves speed. That seems decent. I mean, we could run that guy, but he does cost 4. Ashwood Blademaster, of course, is a classic. He's uncommon, so he's fairly easy to get a hold of. So we can definitely play him. And this way, with our Urgnock... Oh, apparently I'm not logged in all of a sudden. Oh, boy. I might have to refresh the page. I should be logged in. Anyways, with that guy, we can use our Urgnock ability on him, and then we get a lot of value out of him as a blocker and as a an attacker, and he can buff his front end anyways. So we're probably going to be playing a lot of Swift Strikes. Okay, now I need to log in, apparently. Oh, boy. Do this on... Oh, I can't do it on another screen. Well, I don't want to do that in front of my stream. So I got to do this on another screen. So just stand by as I do this. I was logged in. It just kicked me out. Yeah, you don't want to show your login password to people because that shows them how many characters it is. So, pro tip right there. Free pro tips on deck building with the Squire. All right, this is already... I know what happened. And let me just... We'll just close that one. Close all tabs. And then I can F11 that. There we go. We're back. All right, let's get that elf in this deck. We got to get this going so we can finish out the episode strong, right? Another big one we've seen a lot in these limited play tournaments is this Kindle Archer. Now, Kindle Archer is awesome because if you can get that early damage in, or if you need to do certain things, there's a lot of little tricks you can do with this guy, right? It says at the end of your turn, if opposing champion has been dealt damage this turn, he gets bigger. So you can't do it during combat so much, but you can make him bigger over time. Oh, looks like the website's dying on me. We're going to have to refresh the website already. You know your password is star, 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 star. Yeah, you got me. You got me on that one. Anyways, I think Kindle Archer is one that definitely has legs in the Ruby Elf deck. And it's not adding to the deck, apparently. Let's see if I can get a different one, too. No, the website is failing me right now. This is unfortunate. How embarrassing. All right, here we go. It's going to happen for me this time. It's going to happen for me. I'm Joe Dirt. There we go. There we go. All right, next one I really like, and I want to see more people play this card in the future, is the Stingshot Sniper. Now, Stingshot Sniper is another one of our Empower cards that we can double its power and toughness. We can make it a 4-4 flight for 6. It's pretty expensive, but in the late game, you know, that seems like we could be able to do that if we get some resource generation, which we're going to do in a couple of minutes. It says when this attacks, it deals damage equal to its power to one random opposing champion or troop. Now, I haven't tested this, but I do believe that when you do things randomly, it targets all of the opponent's stuff first, and then it can do it to one of them. So that seems to, at least in my mind, circumvent Spell Shield, which doesn't allow you to target, because you're not targeting, you're just randomly doing stuff. And I believe that's how it worked back in Alpha when we used to have a gem, the Ruby gem used to not do damage to your opponent's face, it used to do random damage to one of your opponent's troops. So if something was untargetable, it could potentially hit them. So this should work like that, which means that it can then get rid of your opponent's Hierophant, possibly. Also, if you buff the front end on it, it's going to do more damage, which means it could kill a lot of stuff. So I just see this as being such a huge value card. It's got flight. It's probably going to get through. Seems really good. I'd love to see people play more of this guy. It even has an alternate art, apparently, which looks pretty awesome, too. That alternate art looks awesome. All right, next one is the Fyric Performer. It says, when it enters play, you get a Scorch, you put it in your hand. Now, I like this guy, but it doesn't really do enough for me. I think that if we were going to play this guy, he would go into a different deck. He would go into that Orc deck that we talked about a little bit earlier. So I don't think that guy's really good for us. I was originally playing all the Elf Shards in the deck. I mean, you could put Periwinkle in the deck, but it doesn't do anything because we don't have any 5 drops, so that's kind of a no-go. Ashwood Maestro gives my opponent resources, which seems really bad, especially when there's so many ramp decks out there. We talked about the Emberleaf Duelist. This is one where maybe this one isn't as good as some other stuff. You know, it's going to take some time to figure it out. Fire Dancer I like too because it's just an early game type of card that's going to deal 2 damage. And, you know, even in the late game, we can swing with it, get the 2 damage to our opponent's face anyways, even if they block. So that's what I really like about Fire Dancer. There may be some other buff or something we could throw on him to make him even better. Visage of the Masquerade, or Masquerade, maybe, is a 2-cost Elf Rogue that's a 2-2. It says speed. When you play a card with 5 or more, it gets make another Visage. So again, this is trying to play off of the elves, play really big troops that make them buff them. So really not going to work for us. Another one was Voice of the Ashwood. Now, this guy I really like. Has a Rage 1. When this deals damage to an opposing champion, you get temporary resources. You get one for each damage dealt. So this is how we're going to ramp in this deck. This is how we're going to get there. The problem is it's legendary. Now, it's seeing some price drops, I guess, right now, because people aren't finding a place for it. The problem is it's legendary, and if you're playing it in this deck, you'd need four of it. So maybe that might be something that people wouldn't want to risk just at the chance of trying out this elf deck. I'm going to go ahead and throw these Felroot Acorns in here. They're not completely necessary. It's just nice because we're playing Urgnock, and this can give us that extra health to hopefully extend the game to where we need to be. And I think that was all the elves. Some other ones I had considered. I looked at Blade Juggler. It looked interesting. We've also got War Dancer. It seems pretty good. Now, I guess if you were going to, what you could do is you could play some sort of an elf deck that plays things like War Dancer and Blade Master and Invoker, and then you play the elves that buff when you get five drops in play. So that might be something. This is the last but not least. Ashwood Apprentice does exactly what our Orc Companion did, but better, because in the late game we can pay six, it becomes a bigger body, and now two of our opponent's troops can't block this turn, which seems like that could be rather important, especially when your opponent has really big stuff on the table. So that is my core of the deck, the elf core of the deck. We're at 32 cards right now, and we've got four of those cards are resources, so we're really at 28 cards. So the rest is mostly going to be removal, the typical Ruby removal that you see, right? So obviously we're probably going to want burn in here, but I don't know. I'm still at the place where I'm not sure how much we're seeing Vampire Princess. Burn feels like it's a card that's really good when we played in that Orc deck, if we go Blood and Ruby, because then we can kill Vampire Princess with Burn. Or maybe it's really good in this deck because we have a lot of things with Swift Strike. So then we can attack in, our opponent can make what they think is a good block, we burn them, and our Swift Strike damage kills them before we kill them. So maybe it's okay. Another one I really like in here, like we talked about before, is Burn to the Ground. We're producing some amount of resources, so this hopefully can close out the game for us. Another one that I thought that is kind of not the best is the new Empower Burn spell. Is it this one? This one's good. This one's awesome. So Burning Tendrils does 3 damage to a target troop and 2 damage to the controller. And it's quick action speed, and we really need things that are quick action speed, right? So we can definitely play this guy. The only thing we're not getting is the charge, like we did off of charge. It's not even coming up. Charger? Charge. We want charge. Charge, Crackling Bolt, rather. We aren't getting the charge off of Crackling Bolt if we don't play this. So we may play Crackling Bolt, we may not. The big thing is Crackling Bolt's basic action is, as much as possible in Ruby, I really want to have quick action spells. I want to be able to respond to my opponent during combat, especially when I'm playing Swift Strikers, right? So we're at 45 cards. We'll probably have to whittle this down just a little bit. There is another Empower card that I just did not... I think is actually really bad, and I think people need to figure out that it's bad, and it's rare of all things too, and I'm going to explain why. And I think this needs to be brought to light because I'm starting to see people put this in their decks. So Electrofry is a pretty bad rare card right now just because there are better things. So if we have a rotation of set 1 and 2, then Electrofry gets better. But right now, it's not good. First of all, it's basic action speed. It does 3 damage. We can do 3 damage more efficiently with a lot of other spells. We can empower it to deal 6 at basic action speed, or we can just simply play what we're already playing, which is... I have it on elf, so it's not showing. Which is that we're playing Burn to the Ground. So it has the same threshold cost, but we do more, and we do the same amount of damage when we pay 4 for Burn to the Ground, but we do actually 1 more point of damage if we pay the 8 for Electrofry, the same 8 for burn to the ground does 7 damage. And there's nothing else that Electrofry gives us. And they're both basic action speeds. So I submit to you, Electrofry is just not good right now. Play burn to the ground. It's uncommon anyways. There's really no reason for you to go out of your way to buy Electrofry at this point in time. Now in the future, Electrofry may take the place of burn to the ground, but right now it's just not happening. I did think that was interesting when I saw that, though, and I did the math, and I was like, wait, this isn't good. This isn't good at all. And you play a Blaze Elemental and put it in your hand. Oh, it does 3 to each troop in play? Oh, maybe it's better than I thought it was. Okay. Let me reread it. This is why you're here. Okay. All right. Well, it's definitely better than I thought it was. Okay. It's a sweep. That's kind of a big deal. But still, it doesn't really fit our deck because it's going to sweep our own troops out. So not really going to work for us. But I was more or less looking at it from the I need to remove one troop or I need to remove or I need to just deal damage to my opponent's face. But okay. So definitely better than I thought it was. Okay. So I take it back. Electrofry is good. Even in the current format. But for our deck, it definitely doesn't work. For what we're trying to do. I'll definitely like the tendrils, though. That's definitely staying in. I mean, quick action speed? Come on. Right? I don't know if there's anything else we could really do in here. If you went with dwarves is it maybe a cheaper way to go. You're definitely going to get your Construct Foreman and some of the other dwarves that go in the typical dwarf deck, and you could just go Mono Ruby with it and do that, and you're going to get some nice big fat bodies in there, which could be very helpful. And you could even play some of the elves that we're playing, probably the one, the Empower one that flies that we're talking about, the Stingshot Sniper, might be reasonable to play in there. Let's go ahead and refresh the page. So that way I can see my graphs properly. Now we do have to remove some cards. We got about 2 minutes left in the episode. But do stick around after because we do a giveaway for our live audience. So we've got 4 resources. So this means that we're actually over budgeted, 4 cards. Because we're at 41 cards, and 41 minus 4 would be 37, which is optimally where we want to be. Now, our curve is kind of funny on here. We have a lot of 3 drops, so maybe we need to take a look at some of our 3 drops here and really make some tough choices there. Not so much in the other places. And also our 1 drops, we only have burn. Now, we could go back and play our the classic, what's his name? The orc for our 1 drops. So we don't really have a lot of 1 drops, so maybe we want to play, where is he? I keep forgetting the name of Quash. Maybe we want to play Quash in here. It's hard to say. The big thing is if I play Quash in here, I might want to play something that gives him Swift Strike, so maybe I might want to play Ruby Aura. Maybe 2 Ruby Aura in a deck like this one. To help him out, just to try to keep him alive. Or we could also run whatever it's called. We could also run Crush in here. It's kind of a big deal to save him and keep him alive. Yeah, Crush combos really well with him as well. So maybe we want to run Crushing Blow. Okay, so now we got tons of cards in the deck. We definitely need to whittle it down. Okay, so let's see. In the 3 drops, I think we definitely want to get rid of some 3 drops in here. I still like Kindling Archer. Ashwood Blademaster feels like more of a buff, and so maybe we'll take him down to 2. I do like that he's Swift Strike and that he's kind of a must-answer threat, but he's one that we need to throw a lot of resources into. So maybe he's more of a 2 of. Maybe Kindling Archer is not good as I think it is. It's possible. That might be another consideration. I also am looking at Crackling Bolt because I feel like what we've got is so much better with the Burning Tendrils. So I think that we could take our Crackling Bolts down to 2 instead of 4 and maybe put 2 on the reserves. Yeah, everything's screwing up over there. So put two of those on the reserves. 49 minus 4, we're at 55. We've got Duelist. Maybe Fire Dancer isn't as good as I thought it was, just because by itself, you know. Maybe I was being a little bit too wishful. I'm kind of getting rid of a lot of the wrong cards right now, by the way, but like the wrong cards for our curve, that is. It really feels like some of the ones in the 3-drop range are pretty good, though. Like, I really like Ashwood Apprentice. So maybe Kindle Archer is not that great for us. Just because if we drop it in an open board state kind of late, it doesn't do a lot. Maybe it's just not worth curving into. Just the way things are looking with the deck. Like, what would I prefer to do on turn 3? Probably play Ashwood Apprentice to get rid of blockers. Like, that seems really good. Ashwood Blademaster, I can make all of my stuff bigger threats. That seems really good. Kindle Archer, it's kind of like, well, maybe my hand is empty, and then I don't have anything to play with it. So maybe this is a card that wants to be played in maybe more of a combo deck or maybe more of a tempo deck where there just aren't that as many threats on the board. So maybe we can get rid of Kindle Archer here. Gotta make the tough choices sometimes, right? And we're going over budget a little bit on time here, but I will finish this out. 41 cards. We're at 23 resources. The curve is not the best. What we really want to see with the curve is we want to see this 2 closer to where this 3 is. It's not horrible. Burn to the Ground is kind of like a 2-drop for us. I don't know that I want to get rid of any of these 3-drops, though. We could go up 22. We could go to 22 shards. I mean, I feel like this should be okay. I kind of almost want a 4-drop to trade one of these 3-drops for a 4-drop. But they do empower, and so maybe it's okay to do what we're doing. What did we get rid of that was a 2? Well, we got rid of that guy that was swinging, and yeah. I think this might be okay. I think doing something like this is at least worth a shot to see what it does, to see how well it performs. I don't like the curve right now, honestly. I would want to really work on this. If I was to work on this deck, I want to bring these 2-drops up and then somehow reduce my 1-drops and 4-drops, and 3-drops, and then maybe find a 4-drop to put in here that really does well. Actually, we do have a 4-drop we talked about, which is the Rage. Yeah, Gore Feast. We've got Gore Feast. So we could play a Gore Feast in here. Sure. We could do that. At 22 shards, this should be okay. And this is going to be similar to what he's already playing because it's going to basically be more spells and not as many shards. You could still go on like 1 or 2 shards depending on what's in your hand. Your hand should have decent stuff in it to begin with. We've got this Flying Troop with the evasion that I really like in here. Other things that maybe you might consider running in here is Phoenix, I suppose. Is it not going to come up? Or maybe I'm just spelling it wrong. Or maybe I'm not. Let's see, Flight. Let's just look up Flight. I bet you I can find it that way. Yeah, here it is. I guess I was. So the Phoenix, the Sun Soul Phoenix is another one that we see a lot of people playing. It is legendary, so it might be a little bit tough to get a hold of, and it's fairly expensive, but a lot of people are playing this guy in decks like this, but those are more action-heavy. So I think that we're fine with what we have here. Yeah, so we should probably try this one out. Maybe get rid of, we could get rid of like maybe a Crushing Blow or something. But it feels like this is getting somewhere, but it definitely needs some more work. So let's go ahead and put those Ruby Shards in here and then close out the episode. Big thanks for everyone for stopping by. know there are a lot of other things. What is this person's name? Top if they pick... I can't see the rest of that name. It's a silly name is what it looks like. Alright, let's go ahead and get these ruby shards in here. So there you go. There's your mono ruby elf deck with Urgnock. Oh, we didn't put Urgnock in there. We need to do that. Yeah, we'll run Urgnock in here. Just because he gives them that front end and they have Swift Strike. So it seems like a pretty good little combo there. It even combos really well with our Stingshot Sniper. Oh, I guess we could have put... what's it? We could have put the... We could have put the other guy in here, the human. What's his name? He has a playset of these too. Yeah, we could have put black belts in here as well. So that's another one that actually, you know what? That fills out our 2-point range really well. I keep building this deck even though the episode's over. This is getting kind of silly. So this is like probably our answer to like we don't have enough stuff in our 2-point range and we can maybe figure out how to fix everything else. So maybe go down less on the Ashwood Apprentice. I definitely want a lot of the Stingshot Sniper. Maybe one less of those. And maybe one or two less Crushing Blows. I still really like Crushing Blow a lot, so maybe less of those. And maybe we just fix the deck with that one card. We might have just fixed the deck to curve out a little bit better for us. Yeah, that looks a lot better to me. So we've got, you know, this curve. So what we want to see is a curve kind of like this. I mean, it would be nice to maybe have more four drops that are maybe bodies, something that we can curve into. But at 22 resources, I feel like this should be fine because we can go on two in most cases. Also, we can heal ourselves off of the Felroot Acorn if we need to later in the game. We only need two ruby. We can definitely get there most of the time. I don't think that Felroot Acorn is going to hinder us too much from that. And I think that this hopefully should be able to get you there. So we'll go ahead and close out the episode. So tonight on Deck Build the Squire, we went over some of the metagames and some of the things that we're seeing recently with the Five Shards Tournament. Last weekend, we talked about how next weekend you're going to want to play in the VIP. And if you're not on VIP, go ahead and, you know, go out to the website and you can pay for it. It's a pretty good deal. You're getting a pack a week for X amount of weeks. You get tickets to play in these tournaments. Now, you do have to pay for the tournaments, but it's pretty good value. And what else? We've got, for those people that don't, those free-to-play players that want to play some PvP, we talked about how there's a new tournament style coming up, the Silver. They're calling it, it was the Rock League, now it's called the Silver League, and that's going to be commons and uncommons. Go to the Hex main website, the latest update, to get some information on that. We talked about a little bit about how it is that they produce new cards, and then we built this pretty sweet, at least I think it's pretty sweet, ruby elf aggro deck, which is, you know, let's see, what's the price on this? About $40 if you were to buy it, like, right off the bat. So I feel like that's, you know, pretty fair. The person that we built this for is building up his, you know, stuff. I'm not sure how well this stuff will do, so I should probably play this deck first before it is that we go too crazy. But, yeah, that was pretty much it for the show tonight, so... Until next time, this is Aaron Squire signing off, saying God bless your families. Try not to reach too much out there.